So, Cyril Fleury from NXP, thank you for joining this session about HDCP support in Opti. So, the agenda. I will do first a quick introduction to HDCP, a quick secure video pass overview. I will quickly explain how HDCP is controlled today in Linux, and then a proposal to control HDCP in Opti, so they are preliminary works. So it is not yet implemented, we just started, so we might have some changes, but we'll see. Then a few questions. So HDCP overview. So HDCP is a digital copy protection developed by Intel to prevent copying of digital video and audio. Before sending the data, the source device shall check the destination device is authorized to receive it. And if it is the case, he will encrypt data and he will prevent non-licensed device from receiving content. So today, Android and Linux NXP BSP manage SDCP at Linux level through libDRM. So DRM is for Direct Rendering Manager. So there is nothing preventing a user to disable HDCP protection while we are playing secure content using PlayReady, WideOne or ClearKey. So it is clearly a security hole in the secure video pass. So HDCP support is currently under development to be added at Wayland and Weston level. So there are some upstreaming commits available. But the problem is it is not secure, and there is not yet an open source solution existing to manage HDCP in secure domain. So there are five main versions of HDCP today. There is HDCP 1.x, so the most common one is 1.4. But unfortunately, it has been hacked, so the master key is published, so it is no more considered as secure. Then we have 2.0 and 2.1. Both were hacked before the exit from specification level. So today, we have only HDCP 2.2 and 2.3. That are still not hacked. Yes.
Do you mean the master key for 2.0 and 2.1 is hacked as well?
I don't know why it is what is the status, but it has never been really released because it has been hacked before it was released.
Right. I was just curious, how do you hack it before it's released?
I don't know. So today we can consider only HDCP 2.2 and 2.3. So at HDCP level, so the i.mx item support only HDCP 2.2. 2.3 is not yet supported by i.mx item. So a quick review of HDCP control state machine. So HDCP consider local display as not to be secure. So local display means the display is embedded in your device. So it's a smartphone, it's a tablet. So in that case, you don't need to have HDCP supported. So you are allowed to send clear content, even in 4K. And then, even when you have a local display, if you output the display through analog output, you don't have to encrypt because HDCP is not supported on analog output. It is supported only on digital output. So to have HDCP enabled, you need a non-local display on the digital display. Okay. So a quick secure video pass overview. So NXP implemented a secure video pass under Android. So slides on demo are available from the Hong Kong Connect last year. And today we are currently implemented the secure video pass with Linux BSP. So it has been presented last Monday. So the slides are here if you want to have a look. So I will just mention quickly that for the main contributor to the NXP secure video pass is the RDC. So the RDC is a specific NXP IP, hardware IP that allow to isolate the CPU and all the peripherals inside the IDOTMX M to prevent them to access some secure memory. So typically we can configure the CPU to not have access to the secure buffer, but we can do the same for SDMA, for USB, etc., for all the devices. And typically what we do is we allow only the hardware component involved in the secure video pass to have access to the secure memory, and those hardware components are the CAM. It's a hardware crypto acceleration module. We allow only the VPU and the DCSS. And now we are adding HDCP and HDCP controller. That means, for example, when we configure the RDC in this way, the CPU can't have access to this memory. So the CAM will decrypt the data to be decrypted from non-secure memory, and then will output the result in a secure memory here. And then this memory can only be read by the VPU. The VPU will decode the data from this memory buffer to the decoded one. And again, the CAM is not having access to this part. Only the VPU is able to write. And then the DCSS, who is the hardware composer of the IDOTMX item, will read the data from this memory buffer to send them through the HDMI port. So it's what we call hardware DRM. Yes. Yes, it's a hardware component, yes. You have Trozone IC. Trozone IC is just for the CPU.
Right.
RDC is stronger than Trozone IC. I mean, okay. It covers all the peripherals, all the master bus of the IDOTMX item. We configure it in ATF when the box boot.
Right.
Okay, and then we lock the register. I mean, it's not more possible to change the RDC configuration.
Okay, so even but if it's able to kind of change the attributes of a say page from secure to non-secure, yes, at runtime.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So that means even if Opti is compromised, mm-hmm, okay, the CPU, if you are able to inject your own TA breaking Opti,
okay,
the CPU, as it is hardware DRM, is not able even in trustzone mode to access the memory.
But the memory, this buffers that we're talking about, is it the same buffer, or are we talking about memory copies in between, or are these?
Yes, it's a DDR memory, yes. And we can ask RDC, mm-hmm, this physical memory from this range to this one is okay, secure. Okay, we enter the address, it's a 4 kilobyte window size.
Right.
And then we say, okay, after we create domains, mm-hmm, and after we explain to the system that CAM is in domain 0, 1, 2, or 3, VPU in this domain. And in each domain, mm-hmm, we can allocate up to 8 different memory regions. Mm-hmm. And we can say in domain 0, CAM can read this buffer and can write this one. And we do that for all the peripherals at boot.
Okay.
So typically what we do is we put all the peripherals at the CPU. They are part of domain 0.
Right.
They don't have any access, we don't want access to the secure buffer. Mm-hmm. And then we explain to RDC that only CAM, VPU, DCSS, HDMI, or GPU have access to this secure memory.
Right.
I mean,
so this is runtime configuration.
At boot time, yes.
Only sorry, at boot time.
At boot time, yes. At boot okay. Yes, because if someone is able to hack Opti, he could change the RDC configuration. So we decided to there is a register that allow to lock the configuration. So you can write one time. When you lock the configuration, you can't anymore changing
until you reset.
Only at the next reset, yes, you can change it. So it's quite secure.
Okay, and like just to be very clear, there are memory copies involved in this path, or is
not so much memory copy. In fact, no, not so much. In fact, okay. In fact, we copy the video only when it's not really a copy because we go to encrypted data to decrypted data, and then we go to encoded data to decoded data.
Right.
So there is no really copy. It's just
okay.
Yeah.
Transformations, and then like the memory regions themselves are like statically carved out. Like it's not like Linux is malloc or kind of allocating memory, and then everyone else operates upon it.
No,
but rather you're relying on static carve outs at boot time.
Yes, in fact, at boot we allocate a piece of continuous memory.
Right.
And then we ask Opti, RDC, sorry, to protect it. Mm-hmm. And then we use ion buffer. To allocate memory in this pool,
right.
But it's unmapped memory. That means Linux with only C file descriptor.
Only so a reference to it.
If you try to map the memory, it will have a null pointer.
Right.
Or even if you try to access,
yep.
The RDC will block the access, even in secure mode.
Okay.
Yes. I mean, if the CPU try to read, it will read zero. If it try to write, nothing will happen. But it's really hardware protection. So if you hack one TA, or if we don't care, in fact, because the CPU don't have access at all to this memory. But there is no risk to be able to copy back to a non-secure memory, some secure memory, because the CPU can't do it. Sorry?
You just allocate using a carve-out heap in ION.
Yes. Yes. So now a quick how HDCP is managed today in Linux. So quickly, some very high-level HDCP requirements. So normally, at user space, user applications shall be able to disable HDCP. Because in some use cases, you have clear content, and so a customer can connect a video recorder, a HDMI repeater, or a gaming string, or a PC desktop string, so that is not supporting HDCP. So in some cases, user applications shall be able to disable HDCP. And also, user applications shall be able to notify the user application when HDCP version is not compliant with the content to be displayed. So we can't use a static configuration to protect HDCP register. I mean, we can't set a static configuration at boot as we do for RDC. We need something more flexible. So we can't use RDC to protect the HDCP register, so it's why we need to propose another solution. And for that, we will use Trozone AC. So at the same way, we target to protect the physical range of the HDCP register, and then only the CPU in secure mode will have access to those registers. So today, under Linux, it works like that. So we have the reside application. Then you use libDRM to so DRM for Direct Rendering Manager, not for Digital Write Management. It's quite confusing. And you use the DRM, the libDRM will use KMS to handle the HDCP protection. So typically on i.mx item. It is done through the KMS content protection properties. So you can write 0 if you want to disable HDCP. You can write 1 if you want to ask the system to start to negotiate HDCP version. And then when it is done, KMS will report 2 in this property, saying that the HDCP session is ongoing. So it is not really secure because at any time you can ask KMS to write 0. And so on the trusted application will not be aware. So if you want to check HDCP management in Linux today, so it's available since kernel 4.14. So I put some command how to get the source code and how to generate an image. You will find where HDCP is managed in those two files. So the HDCP hardware IP is not from NXP, it's a Cadence API, so it is using a firmware, so it, of course it is not open source, and it will stay like that. So, so as it is quite new development, there is still some issues. So if you want, by default HDCP is not enabled if you build this image. So if you want to enable it, you have to first stop Weston, because if you try to enable DRM while Weston is running, you will have an error saying that the content protection properties is already being used. So to enable HDCP, you stop Weston, you write with mod test, it is a KMS tools that allow you to access to the KMS properties. You ask to write 1 because it was the value to enable HDCP. And then after some point, the HDCP will be enabled. What is doing currently the driver is starting from the highest level. So 2.2, if 2.2 failed, it will jump directly to 1.4. And if 1.4 failed, it will say HDCP not enabled. So what we propose to manage HDCP with Opti, so first, as I said, we target to use Trojan AC to protect the range address of HDCP registers, like that only the secure domain will have access to the register and read and write. We target to provide a mechanism allowing third-party application as a wide one trusted application or play-ready trusted application to know the HDCP version currently being used by the SOC on that without relying on Linux or Android. So in fact, we target to implement an open source HDCP trusted application that will monitor the HDCP register and this HDCP application will block the configuration changes while we have wide one on play ready session ongoing. So trusted application will support an OEM HDCP API that will allow the OEM to connect this TA to their own HDCP driver or firmware. So of course this one will not be open source because today I know there is open source firmware to manage HDCP. It's very specific source code. And so what is important, it's what we want to do. We want to keep, in fact, the HDCP configuration and management at Linux level to limit the amount of code to be moved in Opti and to just put in Opti what is needed to read and write to the HDCP registers and then plus some checking to know if play-ready session or wide one session are ongoing and if the user level is asking to disable HDCP version or to reduce the HDCP version ongoing. So it's something that it's an API that I will introduce this presentation. So it's new API.
Okay, so this would be some kind of a standard that NXP is working on?
No. It's a proposal after. It's something we can discuss here.
All right.
It's more about the concept that I am sharing here. It's something we will implement. We are implementing that.
Okay.
It's just a kind of POC,
right.
Proof of concept.
Okay.
But you will see the API are quite simple. They are very close to what libDRM proposed.
Right.
So I don't think it will be a concern. But if you have some concern, please let me know.
No.
I am very open to change anything.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so what we propose is to, so we have our RE here with libDRM, etc. That is calling the direct controlling manager. Then we have our non-secure HDACP driver that is OEM dependent. So the idea is instead of to write directly to a non-secure HDACP hardware and driver, we will send an invoke command to the T, asking to do it through HDCP trusted application and then through a secure driver in top of HDCP register protected by TrustZone AC. So I put in yellow the new component we target to add. But there is also some interaction between one TA and PlayReady TA, because of course the HDCP TA needs to be aware of what are doing Widewine off on the PlayReady or any other DRM for direct.
Sorry, another quick question.
Yes.
Why would the HDCP TA act independently of what the Widewine or the PlayReady TA is doing? Because it's like the if there's any content that's being played on the device, that would be using the Widewine or the PlayReady DRM stack, right?
Yes.
So sending the decrypted or the encrypted buffers to a display would be under the control of that stack as well. So
yes, but
wouldn't they be working in collaboration with each other?
Yes. In fact, what we target to do, it's this TA will ask what is the current HDCP version ongoing
right.
to the HDCP TA, and they will not decrypt anymore if something is wrong. So it's why they need to interact.
Yes.
Because if there is no Widewine or PlayReady or ClearKey session ongoing, we can let the user application to do what right. the application wants with HDCP version. We don't care.
Okay.
So, the API we propose to implement and we are currently implemented, so it's quite simple. So we will have a TA HDCP get capability function, typically with two parameters. And so the first one is the maximum HDCP version supported by the SOC, and then the other one is the current version supported by the SOC, I mean the current connection. With a small enum to no HDCP supported, 1.6, 2, 2.1, 2.2, 2.3. So I put 2.0, 2.1 because they exist. They are mentioned in the the Widewine TA, but they should not be used normally. Then one to open the session that will be called by Widewine on PlayReady. Okay, I want to open the session. The same, I want to close the session. So, after we need a proprietary API, okay, that we can't make generic. So typically, we will need a read and write function to HDCP register that will be called by the user space API, plus some check to block the access when the user space is asking something wrong. Oops. So this is what will happen for Widewine API, so Widewine asks to open the session, so it's we are in the Widewine source code. Then we have to change this part, this Widewine part to call open session. Then when we decrypt, we have to add few code to code get capabilities, and then to block the code to decrypt if something is wrong. We do that till we have something to decrypt. At the end, we close the session, and so we close also the LCP session. So at source code level for wide one, it's almost already there. I mean, there is also some check. So the system can get the HDCP version from the streams. And then there is a piece of code that is checking that where we support HDCP, and the required HDCP version, current one, is at least greater than the one currently being used between the SOC and the TV. So what is not good today, it's everything is hard-coded, so the code returns true. We have a local display, so we don't care of the HDCP version, so we just need to change that to do, instead of to return this line, to call get HDCP capabilities. So I'm running short in time, but it will be the same for PLRD, in fact, same mechanism, except that for PLRD, there is no HDCP version management yet, so we have to add more code. So today, so what we target to do, in fact, is to rely on the output protection level, and we will map the output protection level from PLRD. So that is, it goes from 0 to 300, like that, in fact. So we are in touch with Microsoft to confirm they are okay with that. So. Any questions?
On the firmware side,
yes.
It's not so much of a problem that it's a firmware, but quite often, like to get accepted into some of the sort of Linux firmware and things, it needs to be redistributable. Do you know? I mean, do you ship the firmware in your BSP, presumably?
I think so, yes, it's part of the BSP, but the problem is all the i.mx M8M SOC don't support HDCP. By default, the fuse is closed. So if you want a SOC supporting HDCP, you have to order a specific range of SOC. On that factory, they will not fuse the HDCP fuse. So today, in fact, you have the firmware, but it's not loaded at boot because that is not the IP. But by default, if you take if you have the HDCP i.mx item support, you compile the what is coming from Code Aurora, and yes, you have support of HDCP, the firmware is embedded there. It's probably protected, but it's loaded at boot.
Yeah, okay.
But it's not open source, of course.
And the shim layer that would talk to that firmware, can that be open?
The what?
Like the bit of code that's going to talk to that firmware.
Yes, in fact, the source code is already implemented in the two files I mentioned. You can go there.
Yeah.
You will see they are sending messages. There are two bus, one secure bus, one non-secure bus. But yes, all the code is there. What you will not know is what the firmware is doing to write the register. This part is not open source.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
So just so I kind of understand, I might be asking a really stupid question over here. So in the earlier scheme of things, the entire HTCP MMIO space was being controlled from Linux.
Yes.
And the issue over there was that the user could simply disable the protection,
yes.
Right?
So you spend a lot of time to have a secure video pass.
Right.
At the end, you output clear content.
So now we have created a trusted application. So if the user wants to do anything of that sort, it has to go and ask the trusted application.
Yes.
So that means that there's some kind of policy baked into the trusted application when to allow
well,
this?
The policy is basic. What we target to do is to, if there is a wide one or PLRD session, you are no more allowed to change HDCP configuration.
Okay.
We'll start with that. We'll see how it looks.
But like, isn't it possible for the user to just disable this when wide one or PLRD are not in action? Like, just develop another application which gets in touch with.
Yes, if you are able to, yeah, of course, yeah. It's hard to prevent about that. It's why I would expect to use RDC, but as we need a dynamic configuration, it's not possible. So, of course, if the opti is compromised, or mm-hmm. if you put a bad TA, or if you implement a bad driver, of course, you will have a security issue, of course.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you.